Thank you everyone for joining the IHS today for a very special roundtable discussion entitled The 1619 Project, a Continental Afro-Latine Perspective. This roundtable is part two of a larger discussion of the 1619 Project, an ongoing initiative from the New York Times Magazine that began in August 2019. The project aims to reframe United States history by placing the consequences of slavery and the contributions of Black Americans at the very center of our national narrative. So today we will explore the 1619 Project within a wider continental and Atlantic perspective. We have a very distinguished panel of guests joining us today, including Herman Bennett, who is Distinguished Professor of History at the Graduate Center, who recently published African Kings and Black Slaves, Sovereignty and Dispossession in the Early Modern Atlantic, Michelle McKinley, who is the Bernard B. Kliks Professor of Law at the University of Oregon. She is a legal historian interested in the areas of comparative legal history, race, gender, and racialization, and the law of slavery in the early modern world. Her book, Fractional Freedom, Slavery, Intimacy, and the Legal Mobilization of Colonial Lima, 1600 to 1700, won the RMCLAS Judy Ewell Prize for the best work in gender history, and an honorary mention for the J. Willard Hearst Prize for the best work in sociolegal history from the Law and Society Association. Danielle Terrazas-Williams is lecturer in the School of History at the University of Leeds in England. Her award-winning research has appeared in the Americas, Journal of Women's History, and History of Religions. Her book will be published by Yale University Press in April 2022 and is entitled The Capital of Free Women, Race, Legitimacy, and Liberty in Colonial Mexico. And lastly, we're joined by Miguel A. Valerio, Assistant Professor of Spanish at Washington University in St. Louis, and the author of the forthcoming book, Sovereign Joy, Afro-Mexican Kings and Queens, 1539 to 1640, scheduled to be released this August, as well as co-editor of Indigenous and Black Confraternities in Colonial Latin America, Negotiating Status Through Religious Practices. I will now pass things over to Dr. Canizares, who will serve as the moderator for our event today.
Thank you, Ashley. Thank you everyone for being here. Thanks for our panelists and the audience. We are all excited about this conversation. The person who just heard is Ashley Garcia, who is our graduate assistant in the Institute, and she's a fifth year graduate student, and she works on the 19th century on utopian socialism in the East Coast. Well, without further ado, let's begin this conversation. We have four panelists. We'll begin with Miguel Valerio, Professor Valerio, because he has to leave in 40 minutes. And then he'll be followed by Professor Terrazas-Williams. And then Professor Bennett will follow her. And finally, we'll close with Professor McKinley. And each one of you will have 10 minutes. It's an informal conversation. And after the 40 minutes of presentation by each one of you of the topic and the questions that I suggested, although you can take up any other questions or topics you want, we'll begin a conversation, a Q&A. And so we encourage the audience to type questions for the panelists through the Q&A, not the chat, because it's very difficult to follow, for me to access both at once and kind of keep a record of who is next. So Miguel, your turn.
Hello. Everyone, I'm very happy to be here and see dear colleagues and have this conversation. I don't think I will be speaking for 10 minutes. I'm not a person who goes impromptu for 10 minutes, although I have many thoughts about the question here today. So like possibly many of us here, my first interaction with the 1619 Project began critiquing the project for its provincialism, its USism, whatever you want to call it. But as I have seen, the reaction in the US to the project and to the person who worked on the project my attitude has and needed to change, right? As one friend told me when I mentioned my general critique of the project, one thing to remember is that this is not a historiographical project. This is a journalistic project targeted toward a broader audience and targeted to our US audience, right? So I wanna say that because my any comment that I will say here now come from my own feelings about the project and the importance of the project despite any limitations that we may see in the project. So the project as is being asked of us, thus, of course, it can be expanded, right? 1690, all of us know, was not the first time that enslaved people of African descent touch what became the United States, nor was it the first time that any person of African descent, whether enslaved or free, touched what became the United States. But for the purpose of the Anglo-Saxon Protestant myth of the US, 1619 is the touchstone, the cornerstone, right? But what I admire about the 1619 project is its aim to decenter the Anglo-Saxon US narrative, right? By centering the Black experience as part of the history of the United States and the importance of Black people in the process of becoming of the United States, which those of us in the panel here is what we do for the areas that we study, right? And three of us here are Mexicanists or were Mexicanists at one point, and we study Afro-Mexico, and I'm still surprised, given all the scholarship that there is about Afro-Mexico, that people, when they hear about my book or my research, they say, oh my God, there is nothing out there about this, right? But I'm like, no. So this week, when I posted the proofs of my book on Twitter, it went crazy, it went wild. And then the chef from Frontera in Chicago wrote to me and they invited me to go over, and I was treated to this fabulous dinner. But in a sense, I was the beneficiary of ignorance that there are so much research about Afro-Mexico out there, but mine was the one who caught the eye of someone who was acquainted with the chef, and then the restaurant which had done a menu for Afro-Mexico for Black History Month, but focusing on food influenced by Afro-Mexican cuisine, wanted me to come and try the menu. They invited me to a conversation. A conversation wasn't had. I was just wonderfully fed, but I wish I had sat and talked more with Rick Bailey's and the chefs who were, they were also nice and generous. But going back to the 1619 project. So I see now, especially as I have been paying attention to the way that Black History Month is being celebrated in what we can call my cybersphere or my metaverse, whatever you want to call it, the Facebook and Twitter that I inhabit, right? That scholar like us and other people who are aware of the broader global Black experience are bringing these Black experience, are including, right, in the celebration of Black History Month, other non-US experience, right? There's the Dominican writer group, every day they're posting on Facebook about an Afro-Dominican. And this is an important thing to do because of the history of anti-Blackness in the Dominican Republic, right? We just had news that the Dominican president has begun to build a wall, right? And so the Dominican Republic, which is always copying the US, the worst of the US in this case, and so many other cases. If we want to do a project similar to the 1619 project, right, we can approach the New York Times or the Washington Post. And I know that the Washington Post has been doing a series called Perspective, where academics can write about something. And Erica Edwards, who studied Afro Argentina, has written a piece connecting the past to the present and what's going on. So we can approach these venues to speak about the broader experience that we're aware of and that can enrich the conversation. But I also value what the 1619 project sought to do and set in motion in terms of fighting US supremacy in the United States. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Miguel. Our next panelist is Professor Terrazas Williams.
Thank you so much. And thank you all for joining us this evening. For me, it's already 6 p.m. here in England, but I'm thrilled to be part of this conversation. And I really look forward to everyone's questions and really engaging with this topic, because one of the most important things I think came from this project were these broader questions, right? And what I really loved about the 1619 Project is that there was enough for someone like me, for example, in high school or in college to have read this piece at the time, if I was at that stage in my life, and say, oh, what was that about? And so, for example, I was perhaps, as someone who does work on history of colonial Mexico, and specifically on the history of freed and enslaved women, the article by Khalil Gibran Muhammad on sugar was of particular interest to me. You know, there were enough little details there for me to say, it's nice to see the nod, and I would want to know more. So, for example, in the piece, it doesn't really engage the historiography of Latin America. It focuses on bringing people in through this one particular product, the Domino Sugar Company produced sugar. But there are small notes that, again, that if I would have seen this as a young, you know, burgeoning historian in my earlier years, it would have drawn me more to the subject matter. For example, the note about, you know, in 1493, about Columbus bringing over sugarcane specifically from the Spanish Canary Islands. To me, that would have opened up a lot of questions and said, okay, well, you know, what was going on in the Spanish Canary Islands? And as a scholar, historian, professor now, I think about really grounding the framing of sugar production throughout colonial Latin America by first setting up the importance of the Atlantic islands, places like the Canary Islands, Sao Tome, Cape Verde, where really the idea, the experimentation of sugar production first took place, as far as trying to figure out the operations and the viability of plantation sugar before the Americas, right? And so these Atlantic islands play a significant place in the production of sugar all throughout the Americas, but they're not often centered. And so to me, reading that for the first time in the piece by Gibran Muhammad, I was like, yes, that's the detail for me that would have sparked in me something more. And then of course, there's a slight nod to slavery in Latin America, although usually only those who know a little bit more about Latin American history would have caught it, which is noting the importance of Mexico in sugar production, right? That's often glossed over because there's quite a bit of attention paid, of course, to the sugar production of Haiti, and then subsequently in places like Jamaica and Cuba. And so again, that one little piece of detail might have said to me, oh, what was going on in Mexico in sugar production? Was it also enslaved people? We do know that the sugar plantations in Mexico, they did mobilize enslaved African labor as well as an indigenous coerced labor and paid labor as well. And so again, it's the presentation of the material that I respected, knowing that it couldn't be an all-encompassing historiographical you know, intervention into the history of sugar in the Americas. So it was, to me, a great way to introduce people to such a significant topic, right? The even framing, emphasizing this white gold notion that I think many of us who are professors use that in class quite a bit, right? The value of sugar was this white gold that fueled slavery and reshaped the Americas significantly. I also wanted to take a note to think about the sort of the overall project. And I went back and I looked at a New Yorker piece that was by Lauren Michelle Jackson. And she talked about the 1619 Project and the demands of public history, which are always quite high. And so the 1619 Project sort of encapsulates that very well. And she reminded me of, Lauren Michelle Jackson reminded me of a part that perhaps I skipped over a little too quickly when I first read the 1619 Project, which was a note that she she emphasized here when writing, the word project was chosen to emphasize that its work would be ongoing. It would not culminate with any single publication. That's a note from the editors. And to me, it was a reminder to say, again, this is the beginning of a conversation. And if we look at sort of the impact of the 1619 project, what else could we have hoped for? That now we have a forum with, you know, I'm sitting here with three amazing colleagues. We could have brought in dozens of other great colleagues from Latin America, from throughout Europe, you know, throughout the US with the ginormous impact of the academy that we can have, and bring these conversations to light. And so, you know, I think we have to give credit to the start of those conversations and the many ways in which different platforms were mobilized. You know, I was just only recently going back and looking at the Pulitzer Center's sort of compilation of materials they have, but so many other people who are not affiliated with big fancy universities, who don't have the funding, who are pulling together these resources for us in spaces like Twitter, you know, that become these, you know, repositories of knowledge that I think I'm just so grateful for all of our collective work in this. And so, again, I think that some of the things that I really enjoyed about many of the pieces is the way it brings the contemporary as sort of the lens, and then brings us back to this colonial period. Of course, with the sugar, the Domino Sugar Company, many of us who had the opportunity to be in New York or in the tri-state were able to enjoy Kara Walker's work at the Domino Sugar Factory, a subtlety. And so as soon as I saw that, it reminded me of these memories and these conversations I was having in 2014 with my colleagues about sugar and empire and a hemispheric product. And so again, it just reminded me of a lot of great conversations I've been having. But I think this particular forum has been wonderful to bring us together, because it also made me think about the conversations that have been started by my colleagues in Mexico, people like Doris Gariega, Citlali Dominguez, who's a dear friend of mine, a mentor of mine, Maria Luisa Velasquez, but also Christina Maziolinsky, Itza Varela Huerta, and my dear friend and mentor, Adriana Naveda, and just really respect you know, all of the legacy that that there is, not only from U.S. scholars, but also our cherished friends and scholars and colleagues in Mexico, who, again, you know, sometimes, as Miguel noted for us, we're sort of the beneficiaries of people's excitement about our work, because they don't know of the decades. And that's not an exaggeration, the decades of work that our colleagues in Mexico have been doing, both as activists, but also as excellent scholars. And so again, I just wanted to thank everyone for this opportunity to bridge those conversations. And I look forward to hearing more from our audience members as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Danielle. Now, Professor Bennett.
Good afternoon, good morning, and good evening, everybody in the audience. And I just want to thank everybody here, Jorge and your staff, everybody at UT that's made this possible. I just want to just sort of preface what I have to say, because I actually wrote my comments down, but I want to bring your attention to a piece that was just published this past weekend in New York Times, and it's entitled "Trayvon Martin is Still Making America Confront Its Original Sin." And it was published in the Times on the 26th. And I just want us to, and at the end of what I, in my comments, one of the things that you're gonna note is that 10 years later would put us at 2012. And I just want to think about the fact that that history, if it had happened, if that event had happened in 1962, 63, 64, would not be reported by the New York Times. And one of the reasons, as you'll hear me say at the end, one of the reasons why is the kind of normative violence against Black people, regardless of their origins, the normative violence against Black people was not news. It was typical. It was not exceptional. It was a way of which people just regulated, maintained a form of white supremacy on a global scale. And as a result, it was not news and did not invite commentary. So what we need to keep in mind is sort of to think about the wake of that, to think that, oh, here's a history of that, the history of lynching was not something that was commented on in the white press in general. And so that when we come to the publication of Hannah Nicole, we come to Nicole Hannah Jones's 1619 project, we still need to think about its exceptionality. Its exceptionality in terms of print culture, in the history of the United States, but in some ways also the history of the hemisphere, and really for that matter in the history, of the West, right? So that there's a way in which we need to be thinking more carefully about the ways that when we see something that winds up inviting or invoking or raising our attention and it sparks a response in us, we also have to be thinking about when and where these conversations have entered. And I think that that's kind of where the kind of context where I just want to sort of begin with, because, you know, like Miguel noted and Daniela has noted, and I think everyone else in the audience is probably well aware of this, given I see so many of you who work on different fields of Latin American area studies. One of the things that we know is, you know, that all these histories are complicated, and when they're public facing or front facing, oftentimes they get simplified because they're not actually written for dissertation committees. They're not written for, you know, the five or six of our colleagues that we're familiar with, but they're actually written in a particular context where simplicity has to actually be the norm, especially in a place where anti-Blackness produces such an absence, that an absence of understanding of how to make sense of people's lives, people's worlds, and understanding these kinds of past, right? So those are long comments to make a preface. So I'm just gonna get into it. I just wanna make my quick point here and read on to sort of say, in the spring of 2019, Nicole Hannah Jones curated what can only be described as a publishing sensation in the New York Times 1619 project. In the opening essay that frames the 1619 project, Hannah Jones writes, quote, 400 years after the enslaved Africans were brought to Virginia, most Africans still don't know the full story of slavery, end quote. Animated by a desire to position this unacknowledged history, the full story of slavery as America's origin story, Hannah Jones stakes the following claims, quote, to reframe American history by considering what it would mean to regard 1619 as our nation's birth year, end quote. Such an endeavor demands that we center slavery and by implication also Africans and Blackness in the narrative of America. As Hannah Jones writes, doing so requires us to place the consequences of slavery and contributions of Black Americans at the very center of the story we tell ourselves. Who are we in this country? End quote. For Hannah Jones, the moral stakes define our nationality, contemporary Americanness, and collective political futures. Quote, American history cannot be told truthfully without a clear vision of how inhuman and immoral the treatment of Black Americans has been. By acknowledging this shameful history, by trying hard to understand its powerful influence on the present, perhaps we can prepare ourselves for a more just future, end quote. The reactions to these claims and Hannah Jones were vehement and vicious. Right-wing conservatives, including the former Speaker of the House, Newt Gingrich, openly derided Hannah Jones, as did many as such mainstream political historians as Gordon Woods. Battle lines for this cultural war resembled the far left and racial divides with which we are all familiar. Notably overlooked in this public debate was the complex composition of Blackness that defines Black America as a result of Black immigration. Stated simply but starkly, since the passage of the Immigration and Nationality Act in 1965, far more persons of African descent have entered the United States than were forcibly introduced during the slave trade, or forcibly introduced by the slave trade. What histories of the American past structures the thinking of Black immigrants? How do these histories articulate with an ontology that begins with enslavement? What prominence does the middle past epistemology, to quote the literary theorist Michelle Wright, occupy in the contemporary Black imaginary? Asked differently, while thinking with Hannah Jones, might we assume that Black immigration as new Americans also don't know the full story of slavery? Is this equally the case for all Black immigrants, African, Caribbean, and Latin American? Even though we know that slavery figured prominently in their nations' respective colonial past, but also the anti-colonial nationalist and post-colonial imaginaries. Now, I want to shift gears here. I want to shift gears to what Michelle, in some ways, what Michelle and Miguel were sort of alluding to, and that is an observation. Beginning in the 1550s, ethnic Africans outnumbered Spaniards throughout the principal cities of the New World, even in the epicenter of the Spanish power, Mexico City and Lima. It's 1550 already, Africans outnumbering Spaniards, right? And at the height of the trade to Peru and Mexico, that is the first two decades of the 17th century, the moment when she's writing, there were over 200,000 people of African descent 200,000 people were imported. A sizable free Black population already outnumbered the total number of enslaved persons in both viceroyalties. So we already have a free Black population when there were 200,000 being imported in 1619, when we're talking about, 1619, when, we're really talking about 220 Angolans, and the work that John Thornton and others have done really well to point out that these are in fact Angolans. It's really important that we're not actually, that in 2020, that we're no longer stuck in this idea of enslaved Africans, right? Our conversations the grammar of our conversations demands a lot more specificity. And one of the questions we have to be asking ourselves is, why are we still referring to them generically as Africans in this moment, right? When in fact, many of the records that all of us around on the screen and in the chat or in the public here, actually know how to talk about these individuals in much more specific terms, like Mobundo peoples, Bakongo peoples, et cetera, folks from Cabo Verde, Banolos, et cetera, et cetera. And yet our language is a prison house, right? Because our language is a prison house with regard to Black folks, right? We have language of slaves, and then we're sort of trying to complicate that to enslaved Africans. But, but then we're talking about Africans as opposed to, Congo peoples. And I just think that part of our projects and part of the problems that we're always dealing with here is a kind of simplification with regard, a simplification that is the flow or the outflow of an anti-Black thought that most of us, that all of us are really in some ways trying to overcome, but the difficulties of overcoming a hegemonic project that sort of becomes the grammar of our way of thinking or in approaching the study of Blackness in the Americas. And so one of the things, what I want to think about then is if you have 200,000 people of African descent or 200,000 in 17th century, most of whom are Angolans, and then also free Blacks, rather than ask what happened to them, right, which is the Mexican question, right? What happened to them when they go, if you can't see them anymore in the 19th century, what happened, which is a standard refrain that all of us, Miguel and Daniela, all of us have to confront when we go and deal with this our work in Mexico, they should be asking, so how did their, what were their lives like? What were their histories like? What were their experiences like? And trying to untangle that from the nationalist fictions that sort of define, that are sort of so hegemonic in the configuration of the Latin American present and past, right? And in such ways that Blackness is already always an aberration, a thing that has to be inserted, that has to be explained, that has to be contextualized. And it doesn't matter if it's left or right, right? The force of the language of the left, which has a really specific grammar, that a grammar about historical materialism and class, and which is really useful, but always already sort of privileges a kind of formulation of class in which the ontology is that of the casta, right? So that we're reducing Blackness without actually according it a specificity and thinking it through before we get to the casta, so that what we don't have to actually deal with is in fact the composition, the majority of the composition of casta in the 18th century, and for that matter in the 19th century, is in fact people of African descent, where we have lost sight of them as Angolans, as Congo, and specifically as free Blacks, among other things, right? And so, and again, I want to say this, and I think Miguel pointed this out here in relationship to his comments. We've been dealing with this for 30 years. I'm at the point of now having had my PhD well over 30 years, and we're still dealing with questions of of beginnings, right? We're still having to answer fundamental questions. And it's stunning to me when I hear brilliant scholars like Daniela and Miguel, and I want to put a shout out, who are still having to do these kind of rudimentary statements with regard to their work in 2020, right? And that sort of speaks to the power of anti-Black thought that in some ways 1619 Project is attending to in a public sense. So what I want to find, and the final thing, I just want to be deliberately provocative here and sort of say that when we either imagine Black, an African or Black, an embodied problem rooted in the violence of elite ideology in the US and among Latin American elites, whose pervasive hegemonic effects informs our thinking, but rarely is subject to analytical scrutiny, a history, or temporality. And so by way of an example, I recently had the fortune of reading for pleasure and picked up Jean Roberts and Hank Kilbelnoff's The Race Beat, The Press, The Civil Rights Struggle and the Waking of a Nation. The book narrates how the national, i.e. white press, finally brought attention to the plight of Southern Black Americans in the late 1950s, early 1960s. But in order to do so, journalists had themselves to see and conceive of the plight of Blacks as a story, something as unusual, a notable event. In short, the violence that characterized modern Black life was simply normal, if not natural, and therefore had not been national news. The awakening of a nation was simply about the nation consciousness among the white American public, but configured journalists as part and parcel of the public who needed to denaturalize their normative thinking about and conceiving of Blacks and Black life. In other words, journalists had to come to the realization that the violence and the framing of Blackness systematically extended to Blacks was normal, but not a normative condition of Blackness, and to conceive as such allowed expressions of violence not to be seen or treated as a news story. Here then is a site for us to think about violence having a history in the way that it emerges as a problem. And for this reason, what Nicole Hannah-Jones was doing was merely shifting a dial, a small notch, right? And yes, troubling notch in some ways for those of us who work in different spaces, but a small notch to say that we can move from the cruel realism rooted in the problem of acknowledging Africans and Blacks as part of our politics, the American origin story, which is something that each of the panelists has sought to achieve in their work on Blacks in early Spanish America. So my point here is just a very simple one, right? It's troubling in its narrowness, right? But to invite that as a space to critique means that we also have to do a lot of work to sort of trouble the fact of the ways in which nationalism continues to be a way in which anti-Blackness formulates anti-Blackness throughout the hemisphere, right? That most of us are still having to explain the existence of a Black experience, to explain the fact that the Caribbean is part of Latin American history and Latin America history is part of the Caribbean, vice versa, and all of these kinds of things. And similarly, that the Black experience is part of the Spanish experience, right? By 1550, there were 20%, in some cities, there were 20% of the population were folks of African descent, right? And so we shouldn't be always thinking about exceptionalism and trying to sort of, as scholars, take claims to say, oh, look at here, I've made this amazing discovery, but to be thinking much more carefully about what does it actually do? What does that work do? Rather than sort of trying to say, I have this amazing discovery, acting as if we're Columbus in a literary sense or in a historiographical sense, but to actually sort of think this through about systematically, what does this mean in the work that we're doing and what we're hoping to achieve? So thank you.
Thank you. Now somebody will bring us from the Atlantic to the Pacific, the Professor McKinley, to remind us that there's a lively history of Afro Americans all over the Pacific, from Mexico to Chile in the colonial period. Michelle.
Yeah, thank you to everyone, and especially to Jorge for convening us. I've certainly learned so much from my co-panelists in the past about, you know, just reading your work, and I'm grateful for all your contributions that have helped me conceptualize slavery conditional liberty, Blackness and belonging, as I hope I have helped you to think about domesticity, gender, servitude, and liberty, right? You know, in its graduated forms. Many of the prompts that Jorge had offered as a guide to our conversation also serendipitously were echoed in a call for two panels that were put together by myself and Pablo Gomez and Adriana Chira that you know, raised a similar set of questions about the archive of slavery, violence in the archive, the ethics and reading of about violence and rendering it visible. And, you know, it's, I know that I was not able to attend in person, but I know that Herman was there and was able to enjoy some of the tapes. But, you know, the both roundtables, you know, and one was very much convened at our insistence that we included colleagues from Latin America who were working on slavery, working in the archives of slavery to hear what they were saying. Not once did the idea of the 1619 project come up. And it wasn't generative. It just was not something that was generative in our conversations. I think the second panel at the AHA, and you know, Herman, you can correct me if I'm wrong, did think through the juncture of the 1619 project, right, to link racial capitalism and the condition of Black disempowerment and labor labor exploitation. The question is why, and why is that question? And I don't have many answers. I have some educated guesses, and one was what Miguel said. I mean, the 1619 project is a US project. It's a US project. We are Black people located in the US. Well, Danielle, you know, you shipped to you shipped to the belly of the beast. But still, I mean, we are also, I have always thought about this, and I think that this is important for us to think through. We are Black identified people or people of color who, when we go into national archives in Latin America and say that we are thinking about slavery, we look different from like Herbert Klein, or, you know, we just have a different affect and different reception. But you know, part of this is to say, like, you know, if we approach every single part of slavery from the US, the weight of the conversations, the biographies, the movies, the, you know, all of this, what if we were to shift that, right? And to think through this, through the experience of the Atlantic, through the experience of the Mediterranean, think through the experience of the peninsula. Like, my current project is itself not a repudiation at all. And I want to be careful to say this, right? I applaud everything that we know that Nicole Hannah-Jones had to go through to put this in the media, all the blowback, everything that has happened. This is not at all to say. And you know, she's also been very clear that this is not about, you know, she did not do, for instance, indigenous disempowerment, land, you know, but she's like, this is one project, right? It doesn't have to be something for everything. And I have to say, you know, big ups to her, because now I'm completely telling people this when I'm talking about my work on Iberian slavery. It's like, it's one project. It doesn't have to do everything about everything else. But, you know, so I just want to take some time to think through what it would mean to think about slavery and capitalism and race, Blackness in an Iberian frame, right? Because that's my current project. And I'm not taking this away at all from those recognitions or those contributions. But, you know, the documentary evidence in the early modern world is very clear that Blackness at this point in the 1500s, in the 1600s, is not tied to abjection, right? It is not tied to, you know, irrevocably to abjection. It could be tied to, as Miguel says, to sovereignty, as Herman has pointed out, to sovereignty. It could also be, because I blurbed Danielle's book, I know what it's about. It could also be that there is Blackness that is tied to labor accumulation, labor and upward mobility that is, that's not in the frame, right, of the 1619 project. And then I'm also constantly reminded of the context in which we approach the archive in both the Iberian Peninsula and in Latin America. There's still, you know, there's not the No hay negros aquí, but there is more of a, you know, in the national context, there's still a completely different politics of approaching Blackness in Europe anyway. And so, you know, I'll close with two things. One is, of course, a case, and you know, I'm an old-fashioned empiricist, so I'm going to go to the archive. Sorry, Herman, more evidence. You know, I know that it's a thing, but I'm also just going to say there was an exposición in the Prado recently, and it's called Torna Atrás, and it's all about, you know, how the art of the Americas going back. No, this is the Prado, right? The National Museum. You walk into the room of Velázquez, Las Meninas, Tornaviaje. Sí, es cierto. But you walk into Velázquez, right? You walk into this room of Las Meninas. There is absolutely no mention of Juan de Pareja. There are no one knows about Juan de Pareja, right? So that is also a politics of representation that could be linked to, you know, a sort of a popular project that is Nicole Hannah-Jones like that could, you know, happen here. But the other part that I wanted to talk about, and I don't know how I'm doing for time, Jorge, you can tell me, but this other thing is about, tengo tres, 3 minutes? Okay. I can do this quickly. So, you know, I found a wonderful case, and it is a case that's brought before the Real Audiencia of wage earning slaves in 1615. And, you know, I was trying for the sort of the niceness of a 1619, but I found 1615. But, you know, these are wage earning slaves who go in front of the king and the Real Audiencia, and they say, look, we need a reduction in our jornales because of the general recession. And, you know, if we paid such and such, this is what we owe. And what was curious about it was that they had pawned their letters of freedom at this point. And I thought to myself, I had always thought that the Carta de Libertad was the end of the trajectory from slavery to liberty. I never thought that it had a monetary value. I never thought that it could be repawned. And so what I'm saying is that when you think through capitalism or labor or property from the position of people who are in an early modern context, how does that change the way we think about slavery? How does that change the way we think about liberty? Those to me are more interesting questions, right? I know that there are lots of things that possibly could be generative. I mean, I do also think that for people who are working in the North American context, there's really no citational liability that they don't look at Afro-Mexico, Peru. You know, we have more of a citational liability that we don't cite their work than them to us. There's linguistic barriers that, you know, that we have to traverse that they might not. But, you know, if what Jorge has done here is to issue a sort of a conversation as to what a 1619-like project, which is, you know, a popular project, which is a project that really does seek to put into the public eye the issue of slavery and race and capitalism and violence, then, you know, what does it actually do for us? And then my other question to Jorge is it supposed to be generative, or can we generate our own questions, right? So with that, I'll just stop.
Well, thank you, everyone.
I've been in time.
Yes, you did. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for this very thoughtful. Miguel, thank you very much. I was about to ask you a question before you leave, but I'll let you go.
I can stay for the question.
Okay, well, wonderful. Since you are leaving, I mean, most of you have.
I'll be late.
Most of you have in your scholarship have very important things to say to African Americans in this country in terms of an hemispheric history. As Michelle said, that is not just about enslavement, but it's also about freedom, sovereignty, and in the case of Michelle, the power of the church, the utilization of the legal structures of not only lay institutions but also church institutions in order to gain freedom, or fractions of freedom, whatever that is. And so I am very curious about your work, Miguel, that is forthcoming on the celebration of king of monarchy, African monarchy in Mexico in the mid 16th century. As Herman said, in Mexico by 1600 had already received as many African slaves as the continental US received in three centuries, about 300,000 of them. So which renders Mexico kind of as central to African-American experience as is the United States. So one wonders, what is the focus of your scholarship that would speak to an African-American community that is US-based? What lessons would this community get from your findings? That is not just about the topics of 1619 project.
So the practice that I study, this practice of performance with kings and queens and princes and dukes and all kinds of royalty, is a tradition that was all over the Atlantic. So in the 70s, Pearson studied this in New England in the 1800s, in the 1700s. It was called Black Governors for a Day, but there was also a king. And there was a piece that was written in the Atlantic by, I can't remember her name now, she's at Harvard. And she was working with a Black Mason which is a project I wanna get into next. But the Black Mason has something very similar. They has this kind of situation. In my book, I am centering Mexico as a place where, for example, my book, I discussed the earliest American documents we have for this tradition. But as Herman knows, my documents end in 1640, which is when we have records of this tradition everywhere else. But Mexico is the beginning place. So the first chapter of the book is called The Origin of Black Kings and Queen and the Birth of the Black Atlantic. If I had 10 years and if I didn't have to get tenure, I would have gone into the Pacific, which is my next project, right? But I had to get tenure, so I had to stop at the Atlantic. As Michelle said, it's one project, right? So I had to stop at the Atlantic. But there's another wonderful book that is called From the Kingdom of Congo to Congo Square, which argues that New Orleans Black Indians are part of this tradition, right? And so that book, which is a great example of kind of this global scholarship of linking a tradition that begins in the Congo And as Herman was saying, we need to go concretely about where these things are coming from, right? Angola, the Congo, because this is in the period that I studied, this is when people are coming to Mexico. Most Africans coming to Mexico are coming from Angola and Congo. And this is why Haywood and John Thornton's work has been so important for understanding this, right? But this is where they're coming from. And also, I live in St. Louis, where the French were, where the Spanish were. We just had Mardi Gras, and I was talking to my students about carnival and all the connections, right? The whole globalizing, right? I'm always globalizing the classroom, right? I think that if someone reads my book and they read where I mention and have footnotes to the US sources, the US scholars who have studied this tradition, right? In the US, right? That will be like Danielle was saying, if the Sugar article had something more, oh, what is happening there, right? So I hope that people that read my book and see these reference to this tradition in the US will also, you know, be curious and go look. So the Pearson book is called Black Yankees, and he has two chapters about Black governors, and one of them is called Black Kings. And then Jerome DeWolf, who is publishing like crazy, right? He has the book about Black Indians in New Orleans, Mardi Gras, and he's coming out with a book which is about the importance of Catholicism in early U.S. in what became the U.S. Right, but what Jerome DeWolf is doing there, he's looking at, you know, how the Spanish and French presence in what became the U.S. Was important, and now even the Spanish fashion to New Spain was so central to the historical development, right, of what became the US. But of course, if you saw Ken Burns' How We Conquer the West, you see there how that all got erased, right? In a very agrosso modo, right, in Ken Burns, because it's a popular project, he's not gonna do an in-depth historical analysis of how the Spanish past gets erased from US history, or, you know, how Black gets suppressed, like Herman was saying. And I'll stop there because I can go on forever about this one. And I'll have to leave. So it has been so good to see everyone. I'm sorry to miss the rest of the conversation, but I have to go finish and have a discussion on SAB. So bye-bye, everybody. Hope to see you all soon in person. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you very much. He left, but one of the interesting things I would like to know is this, and Herman has worked on it, this tradition of cofradías that Miguel is studying, these of constitutions of participation in republics, that is part of a republican tradition of the continent, of the hemisphere, that we have forgotten, that begins in these type of institutions, that we need to rescue, that we need to reflect on, et cetera. But going beyond that, I'd like to go back to the original reflection. So what is Latin America and Afro Latin America and the Afro Caribbean has to offer in terms of rethinking to Black audiences and Afro-American audiences, the history, their own history, the 1619 project, from a less nationalistic perspective. Is it only about freedom and slavery, or is it's about other topics as well? Which is, I think, the tension that we have in the panel right now between Michelle's points and Herman and Danielle's points. I don't want to make up a fictional conflict, but I perceive that there to be a different take on the subject. And by the way, Michelle, next week on Monday, we'll have another panel in Spanish on Tornaviaje, with very distinguished Latin American historians and European historians on this very topic of how is it possible that El Prado for the first time ever has introduced Latin American colonial art into the this museum as if severing the history of the Spanish monarchy into a Eurocentric perspective that has overlooked the rich history of art.
So let me jump in on this because I think it's actually really important to think about this framing where we're at right now as, you know, sort of Nicole Hannah-Jones is a nationalist, it's a nationalistic project in relationship to the American discussion. There's no question about that, right? And it's also, and that has a lot of different reverberations. Just keep in mind, politically minded African Americans, especially those who are Black nationalists, we know we're not actually interested in the 19th century, or for that matter, in the context of the Black Power movement, we're interested in the history of slavery, right? Despite its importance to Black people in the context of the United States, if you look at the work of like the Black art movement, and in the early Black students, Black studies movement, one of the things that really came out was like, let's not actually focus on slavery, precisely because, there was nothing dignified, and they were building on the work of 19th century Black nationalists from David Walker to Henry Highland Turner to et cetera, including also Du Bois, who were really reluctant to think about, as in his cultural nationalist phase, to think about slavery, because it wasn't something that really brought, it wasn't a heroic tradition to bring into it, right? And so there's that. But then on the other hand, it's interesting to, what I really value right now is the emergence of Afro Latin American scholars like Miguel and others who are actually doing this work, because much of the work that was being done after, in Mexico, was really actually being done like by Aguirre Beltran. And it really was actually done by Caribbean scholars, Black Caribbean scholars, Frank Knight in Cuba, Colin Palmer, and Leslie Rout and others, right? Afro-Americans or Caribbean peoples who are introducing these subjects into the conversation in the context of Latin America. And they were, and so they preceded many of the scholars in Mexico. And it's really important not to forget that, right? So that there's a kind of transnational conversation or transnational dialogue that prompted that, right? And it didn't actually come from Black communities and it didn't start there, or at least when it did start there, it wasn't actually heard by the elites. It wasn't heard by the elites in those countries until Afro-Americans brought with them, sort of their gringo dollars, and we brought a certain kind of like presence to that subject. And in fact, we were struggling to be heard when we were entering the field, mostly the Latin Americans were like, in our country, the people trained in Chicago and Stanford and Harvard were looking at us like, oh, you're doing some kind of aberrant study that's not really important, right? And if you look at like who we are, and like in my generation and where most of us were placed in terms of our jobs and where we could get published and what boards and so on, that work, our work was not representative, right? And yet we engendered a field that created an opening, which is now not coming necessarily from Black Colombian communities writing history in the first instance, or in Ecuador and Argentina and so on. It lives in the form of articulation with Afro-Latin American studies, Dominicans who are trying to deal with their race and their issues of race as a minority community and so on. So, and other groups like that. It's a complicated set of questions. And it's also like trying to think through questions of affect, right? In Afro-American histories, there's much more of an acknowledgement that slavery had an impact on the interiority, right? That's a fundamental thing, which is a reflection of the fact that when you're writing, saying like, hey, what was it like, as philosophically, what was it like to spend 300 years under enslavement? Right? There hasn't been that kind of opening in Latin America. That hasn't been an opening. I was just like scanning all the works this past week. And one of the few people I've seen writing around those issues is Jason McGraw's work on Colombia, right? Where he talks about, you know, on emancipation, right? Where he's looking at some poets and a few people have that, but most of the Latin American scholars haven't even allowed for that kind of opening. I mean, you read George Reed Andrews, whose work, who has been so fundamental to Afro-Latin American histories, but there's no acknowledgement of affect, that slavery had an impact on people's experience, which is fundamental to the work of Colin Palmer, fundamental to the work of Leslie Rout, fundamental to most people who have been thinking about slavery as a cultural institution, as a social institution, and not just as an economic or a political institution of domination.
Michelle or Danielle?
I just have a question more and a reaction to this, because I mean, what you're talking about, Herman, is a sort of an intellectual history that needs to be written on the development of this project, right? And I have seen it written in local contexts. You know, certainly how in Peru you see this written for indigenous history. I have seen bits and bobs for Latin American studies in Afro Latin American studies, but I think, you know, the big of course, this is always going to come back to Tannenbaum, right? But this, like, the idea that Tannenbaum was this refugee who looked at racial relations in, you know, a different time in the 60s and saw something different. I don't see that has been our story, right? And I'm wondering if this could be an invitation to write this in a collaborative way of, you know, a newer generation of, well, I'm not new anymore, but, you know, a different generation of people writing after Palmer, writing after, but also recognizing those connections. The other thing, Jorge, I would wonder where you would put this is Brazil, right? Because we don't have a Brazilianist here, which is also, you know, like the US in a certain way, big regional differences, long-standing slave society, deep historiographies, and deep historiographical questions that are internal, right? I'm just wondering, is the time kind of ripe for us to start thinking about our own intellectual history? You know, like, we now have so much production in this field. Like, why not start and just say, okay, how did this actually happen, right?
Just can I make a just quick point? I already think it's there. I just think it's just
packaged. I just haven't seen any.
Laura Lewis's, you know, chocolate and corn flowers. It's basically Claudio Lomenitz's work on Mexican nationalism. It's basically it's Tom Skidmore's and, you know, Jerry Davila's work on race and intellectual. This work has already been there because it's, in effect, the questions around it, eugenics and all, you know, all of that work, those folks have all focused on it, right? You know,
no, I get the part for like the 20s and the, you know, that part. I'm just thinking trans, like Chile is not in that conversation. Argentina is not in that conversation. I mean, I'm wondering how to kind of, and I'm also wondering if it's the moment, I mean, to do this kind of work. Like, we are training graduate students. Would we advise them to go into this field to look at the intellectual history of Afro-Latin American studies? And, you know, maybe that's a dead end, right? Who knows? But I'll leave it there.
I just wanted to connect two things that both Herman and Michelle were sort of referencing. And one was thinking about the internalization of the trauma of slavery and thinking about those longer legacies with specific areas of labor. One of the areas that I thought about immediately was thinking about activism amongst domestic workers in Brazil. And that being sort of a common issue that people are bringing up, you know, what does it mean, you know, for slavery you know, to have lasted so long and for people to not necessarily transition out of the expected labor that was previously demanded of them, especially of Black women. And so, but most of that work that I've seen has been around sociologists. I haven't seen a lot of work on it for amongst historians, but you know, I used to teach more contemporary Latin American history up until just recently, so I try to keep up with the historiography. But if any of our audience members know more about those legacies, and if people are having those active conversations, I would love to learn more. But I think there's sort of a dearth of scholarship in perhaps the areas we know best, and domestic worker activism is the only place I think that I've read about it and heard about it from my colleagues who do work on it.
We have a lot of questions already in the Q&A. I wonder whether we could turn to them. The first question is by Aaron O'Connell about the controversy. Sean Willett's criticism of the 1619 project, which is essentially that is historically inaccurate when it comes to independence, and also Lincoln that was opposed to Black equality, and third, that during the long struggle for civil rights after the Civil War, for the most part, Black Americans fought back alone. His question is, are these historical errors or just interpretative differences? Any takes on that?
Yeah, this is complicated, right? It's like, you know, think about it. You're thinking about Sean Willance and Gordon Wood, who are prominent political but also cultural historians who are spending an enormous time writing from this perspective. From the perspective of the nation and of great figures, George Washington, lives of George Washington and others, and political figures. But you know, this even take Aaron's. It's a great question, and you know, obviously, you know, a newspaper response on the Sunday Times magazine when we're all waking up and we're just like having our bagels and drinking coffee is, you know, you're not going to spend a lot of time with all the details of the footnotes. And, you know, but at the same time, one could argue, you know, shit, yes. It's like Afro-Americans who, you know, Afro-Americans in many ways to the third part had in places like South Carolina, in places in significant parts of the United States, were abandoned by the federal government, right? Were abandoned by the federal government, which basically meant that they were left to build their institutions, to their churches, the things that allowed them to become literate. They struggled for voting rights, all of these kinds of things, largely on their own. And, you know, and there were periodic moments when some things like, you know, like the populist movement in the 1880s and 90s basically saw an alliance with Blacks as a way of sort of fighting against, you know, the landowners. But for the most part, Black folks were outside of the civil sphere. And when they had to crawl themselves back into that, right? And so I think that that's one of those places where, you know, sure, you can find a few white allies, but you know, that's not the sum total of like, that's not the sum total of an actual partnership. That's just a few allies, right? So I just want to, you know, I want to just be very careful. Black folks built many of those institutions on their own, the educational institutions. You know, we educated ourselves, and by implications, created a space that allowed for white Southerners, also poor white Southerners, also to be educated. In terms of some of those other kinds of questions, you know, it's like, it's big history versus, you know, Sunday magazine writing.
Well, just a question for you guys, having to do with Lincoln and whether he believed in Black equality in Aaron's question, which is the fact that there is something distinct about the US, it seems to me. When I see the Constitution of Texas, 1841, I find something striking, which is the definition of citizenship. and the role of Blacks. Blacks are not citizens as free. They cannot be constitutionally. They cannot be. They can be only slaves, which is such a radical difference from Texas under Mexico, where the Alamo is constructed about these very different conceptions of citizenship for Blacks by somebody like Iturbide, Blackness is not necessarily associated with slavery. Most of Blacks in Latin America are free, living as vecinos in towns of free Blacks, etc. We have slaves, but the great majority of people are still free and participating in these discussions of citizenship, which is not the case of Lincoln defines Blacks, free Blacks as Africans, and Africans, free Blacks in the United States define themselves as Africans in the 19th century up until Reconstruction, which is not the case of Latin America. So there are big, big differences between these two spaces that need to be discussed, need to be part of this conversation that render somebody like Lincoln really, I mean, provincializes Lincoln, if you want. That is not really, I mean, the fact that he defined Blackness as African, free Blackness as African, is in and of itself telling. I don't know whether anybody of you cares to comment on that, or which, so should we move to the next question?
I mean, we can move to the next question, but I was just thinking the 1812 Constitution of Cádiz is the same thing, right? There is something to be said for future studies in which Blackness and citizenship is, you know, in a tense relationship, but really comes to the forefront when whiteness and masculinity become the key markers of citizenship. But I know that you have other questions, and I don't know how much longer do we have, Jorge? I'm not sure.
We have about 20 more minutes, but
okay. So we should probably move to next question, yeah?
Yeah, I really appreciated Professor Bennett's comment on having to make the same basic points about Afro-Latin America in our presentations and writings. I find myself having to do the same when discussing Blackness in Brazil. Do the panelists have suggestions and ideas about these and a way to move beyond this?
Maybe I'll just make a brief comment. You know, Herman talks about how when, you know, he was completing his degree, you know, the frustrations of being seen as someone doing, you know, a discrete project on sort of an insignificant population. And I remember speaking, you know, as a generation below him, speaking with my advisor, Pete Siegel at Duke, asking, you know, will I be seen as a true Latin Americanist for these jobs that are advertised as colonial Latin American specialist, and feeling like I had to fight so hard to demonstrate that I knew everything about colonial Latin America outside of Blackness. So it's something very real. I think even for the generation after me, trying to figure out these siloed spaces of even categories of jobs, right? That we are sometimes not seen as sort of fully Latin Americanist or true Latin Americanist if we're not focusing on dictators or something like that. So again, solidarity with this frustration that continues on. You know, I don't know what is going to be the tipping point for Afro-Latin Americans to be allowed into this conversation that is on a greater scale, because it's not as if Afro-Latin Americans aren't talking about this all over, you know, the continent. And so I don't know how best to get this information out than trying to reach people more broadly than, you know, of course, our scholarship, and we all do this. But I would say that, you know, some of the ways that people have felt more grounded in the information that I provided is offering these stories, you know, that, you know, as Michelle noted, I thought about what's sort of the earliest case that I found this history of this dynamic free Black woman, Ana de Arriaga, and it was 1586, to say that there's a longer legacy here. One of the other strategies that I've employed throughout my career is saying, you probably know a little bit more about New Orleans, or for example, you may have read Jessica Marie Johnson's book. There's another great book about similar cases in Latin America, or, there's some interesting, if you wanna know about legal history and you wanna understand it in sort of a context outside of common law, read Michelle McKinley's book, right? It gives the blueprints of really understanding how law worked in a more hemispheric way. And so, unfortunately, I know that I always sort of often rely on going back to, what do you know about US history? I can find you cases much earlier, sometimes 150 years earlier, that speak to the Afro-diasporic experiences and those longer legacies that we can talk about. Is it fair for the US to be the primer? No, I don't know when it won't be. I hope it doesn't stay that way, so.
And I think that, I think that you're absolutely right. It's nice to be hopeful about these things, but I also think it's possible. I mean, we want to be very pointed here. I want to think about Jorge's first book, right? And that was a book that when I read it and really reflected on it, that it was basically somebody who was trying to say, there's an intellectual history on the part of folks from Latin America, that they weren't just sort of engaged in mimicry, that they had thought, that they had a philosophy, and it was a book that also was shifting the epistemic ground. And it also didn't hurt that when I thought about how he was framing who he was, his relationship to these ideas, that he was also situating himself as somebody from Latin America, I believe Ecuador, and was trying to actually take on not only just sort of Spanish writing, writing from Spaniards, but really also the framing, the kind of epistemic frame that came about through sort of liberal thought with Adam Smith and others, right? And so that there was a way in which it was an epistemic shift that he was interested in, that was kind of an acknowledgement of saying, like, look, this space has thought, there's intellectual history going on in Latin America, of which I'm a part of, but I'm not an originary thinker on this, but I'm just building on what it was there, and that's what makes it original. And I think that kind of intervention is what Afro-Latin Americans might actually have to be doing too, right? And I think that work is already being done in different places. It's some of it's about, like, graduate admissions in a kind of piecemeal way, and that's going to take a century, right? Because what we know right now is that at the rate that we're going right now, at this moment of all of this diversity and DEI, whatever, it's going to take a century for graduate admissions to reflect where brown and Black populations are at this moment, a century from now. Right. So that's piecemeal, right? We're not going to be, most of the people around here and this thing aren't going to be here when that's going to happen. Well, we're just going to get to that number, that percentage. But that's what institutional change is. That's what intellectual change, how things happen. But on the other hand, I would say, we also have to create space. I mean, at a certain point, I'm looking forward to being irrelevant in this field, right? Because there are ways in which, just for the example of Jorge, at a certain point, there are certain kinds of conversations that my work shouldn't actually have, I was thinking about creating an opening, right? I was thinking about creating an opening that was more about sustaining power, I felt I had more sustaining power than people like Colin Palmer, precisely because I stayed in the field, as opposed to saying, like, I'm beat down by this, I'm leaving the field. Instead, you create a space for your graduate students to be able to ask this. I basically work mostly with, people, Afro-Latinos, who are asking these kinds of questions in different parts, and also people from the Caribbean who are trying to enter this kind of conversation, right? And that's also because of the institution I'm at, where that's the case. But I think that these aren't just intellectual histories. These are epistemic questions, and they're political questions. And they're also questions about, what kinds of questions that need to be asked at this moment. Like, if we knew what those questions needed to be now, then that's bad politics, right? That's ahistorical politics. We don't know. In the future, it might all be that we just need to be thinking about fundamentally different things and writing different kinds of histories. I'm not writing the same history I wrote 30 years ago, precisely, you know, even though I'm working through the same archive, I'm asking different questions.
There is another important question I hear from Lisa Voigt about what can scholars focus on Latin America contribute to the struggle against educational gag orders or anti-critical race theory bills? Any insights? Okay. Daniel Dominguez has a number of
I just wanted to acknowledge Lisa. Hi, Lisa. I just wanted to acknowledge that. I mean, this is something that is would be too facile to say, oh, well, you can study it in a different register. I mean, and not realize that we're in this all in the trenches, right? When we're talking about history, we're talking about exploitation, we're talking about race. And academic freedom. And just because we do it in different places other than Virginia should not be an exit ramp off, right? So Lisa, thank you for the question and great to see you.
All right. I think her question provokes the issue of, when I teach my students the issue of American exceptionalism, what is really exceptional about the United States? And I think it's the pathology of white supremacy and the pathologies of how race was defined in these places. But in any event, there are other questions and statements by Daniel Dominguez. I'd say that time is ripe in Brazil, the recovery of the works of Bicudo Gonzalez, Nascimento and others. Also the talents of Inea Lopez, Jamila Ribeiro, Ana Flavia Magallanes Pinto, etc. So he's referring to a set of historians. And one exciting development in the history is the rise of the emergence of historians, historiadores negros network in Brazil. That there is Afro-Brazilians that are writing histories of Afro-Brazilians nowadays. But these are not questions, but just statements. And there's a question here by Gerardo Carlo. I agree that 1619 project is important since at least it creates a conversation. What? A conversation. Am I muted? No.
Yeah.
Okay. A conversation, hold on. It says, I agree that 1619 project's importance is at least it creates a conversation about Afro-American history, but I question if it is productive to spend so much energy in questioning the white people's simplistic fairy tale about the pilgrims landing and the glorious origin of Americanism, while the real question is the progress, advantages, and inevitability of the cultural and racial mixture of South, Central, and North America. Well, there is no question here. I'm looking for questions. Given the limitations of the archive, how can we reconstruct the interiority of the lives of Angolans, Congos, et cetera, in colonial Latin America? How would we do that when writing these stories? But this is by Christian Reyes.
Well, I would say that I've been giving a number of talks in the last couple of years as part of this book that's coming out on the 18th century. I think that that's a little bit of a fiction, right? That's where, you know, Michelle used this word empiricism. You know, it's like most of us are actually working in and through archives. You know, it's like a question about what the problem in the context of this discussion in the United States, there's this whole thing of paucity and scarcity and lack of material. That's not the issue in Latin America, right? The issue in Latin America, in most cases, most cases with regard to the peoples of African descent, is it's a question of excess and access, right? There's an excess of data and excess of work, right? It's having the discipline and having the kind of willingness to actually take in what you might perceive as insignificant people and to spend your time thinking about them, right? Thinking about, so to sort of say, you can simplify and be like, oh, they're all Africans, or you can actually think about saying like, well, they're Angolans and Bakongos and so on, and look at these practices. And it's interesting to me, I mean, sort of in the first book, that I wrote, I spent a lot of time actually putting names to very basic folks in the context of the 17th century, saying Maria de Angola, right? And sort of thinking through the archive, but the fact is that she mobilized that name, right? And that she was actually saying something about her interiority in terms of how she was manifesting itself in a form of transaction. And that meant that the book was a little unwieldy and unreadable to some people, right? Because you have to actually have patience to think about Black people. You have to have patience to go in there to sort of say, oh, these people have names, and here's another case of that, and here's another case of that, as a way of demonstrating a kind of embodied or habitus in the kind of Bourdieu-ian way. But the problem is when the history, when Black history is always having to be made told, being made to be relevant to a larger particular narrative, then you don't have, then you don't actually have the patience to sort of go in to restructure things. And that's one of the difficulties. I mean, I'm sitting right here in my writing space. I have at least a two boxes full of like Inquisition cases that are about 200 cases, right? I can't get through those. I can't get my students to actually spend enough time thinking about that, because they're trying to figure out how to, how am I going to get a job if I have to spend like 5 years reading this stuff? So the problem then is really also about, having the kind of patience and having the privilege to be able to dig in into the stuff. And I think that's I don't want to start with the premise that the issue is scarcity, right? Most of us working in this stuff, we're not dealing with scarcity. We're dealing with too much and excess.
I wanted to add something to Herman's line of discussion here, which is thinking about specifically the politics of erasure that we can follow to think about interiority. So for example, I often teach this piece by Catherine Joy McKnight, and it's about a Black woman named Maria Blanca, who is brought before the Inquisition because of a blasphemy accusation against her. And so while they refer to her as a negra, right, she refers herself as a woman who's Congo. And so they keep trying to sort of take that away from her, throughout the inquisitorial process, and she just re-emphasizes it. And we see that there is value to her, to this identity, right, to this ethnic tie, right? And so, there are ways that we can see this, even in quantitative history, which, I'm still a fan of. I'm actually teaching two pieces this week, one by Paul Loken, who looks at colonial Guatemala, and then the other by Flavio dos Santos Gomez, that looks at 18th century Rio, or Rio, and both use quantitative history to look at the choices that are made specifically around, ethnic endogamy. And so in Flavio dos Santos Gomez's piece, we see that, for example, as Herman emphasizes, there are Central Africans who are choosing to be with other Central Africans as compared to, for example, West Africans. And so there seems to be something going on with their preference for choosing partners of Central Africa more broadly. And then he also breaks down and gives, a specific sort of, as he calls, nations, identifications, and sort of does that cross-section across hundreds sometimes of cases. And I think that there's a way that we can make an argument that, those ethnic ties still matter, that specifically when he looks at cases of Central African women, that they might be the ones sort of guiding their daughters, but also sons, in choosing Central African partners, which I found really fascinating, that we could read through the interiority of Afro-Latin Americans' choices with regard to their very personal lives through things like quantitative history. And so I highly recommend reading both articles sort of in conversation with one another to get a sense of that methodological approach to sort of get to the possibility of understanding some of the sense of self, right? Which is really challenging to get to, which I salute, you know, everyone trying to do that work, including everyone on the panel.
Michelle, any reactions?
Well, to the question of interiority and the archive, I mean, that's everything that I try to do in my work. And so it's not easy, but, you know, a lot of the ways in which we read the archive of slavery is you don't expect privacy, you don't expect domesticity, you don't expect intimacy. So you don't read for that. Whereas, you know, as Herman and Danielle point out, of course people are representing themselves, even though they are representing themselves to notaries in front of the Real Audiencia as miserables, as whatever, but they're making claims, right? And so I don't have had an issue with finding interiority, intimacy, and it could also be the sources that I'm looking at, but the Inquisition, divorce, I mean, anybody who's ever been divorced is going to see a whole lot of interiority right there. You can see that in an ecclesiastical archive. The ways in which people represent themselves as Angolas, as, you know, cofrades, as whatever, you have to, I would imagine that we're training our students to read in this way, right? That is, this is not just a moniker, this is the way that people are representing themselves as people of honor, as people who are nonetheless degraded by the very institutions that they are in front of, right? A vuestra señoría, pido y suplico, but they are saying they have a claim, right? They are saying they have a claim. The formulaic ways in which they say como más allá de derecho, no, and lugar, and they're appropriating that to say, look, I deserve to be here, and this is my claim. So I hope that that question is kind of like a throwaway, because the three of us and Miguel, who was here before, this is our what we've been doing, right? Reading the archive for interiority, for honor, for respectability, I guess is the way that American people would talk about it, but. Anyway, Jorge, are we over time?
I think we have reached our limit, but.
But can I just say, Jorge, I just want to I think it's really important to say that what's different is, I think that claim making is actually what is animating 1619, right? It's actually sort of saying, you know, it's not just about training graduate students. It's not just about training our students. It's about entering, it's about writing that into the New York Times and to sort of say, you know what? Black birthright citizenship means that you actually have to take serious that from the very beginning, Africans and people who are Black were foundational to the American narrative, right? And I'm not so sure where we see that in the context of the Latin American periódicos. I don't know where that is, right? And so it's, I just want to make sure that we're not having these kind of false comparisons, because the issue is that we started this with a newspaper article and saying and thinking about what it's doing, right? What a newspaper, and I wonder what does that conversation look like in the context of Latin America? Right? So us doing this kind of work and us trying to do it for our students is not the same thing as somebody who's saying, I'm writing this in the New York Times, right? I want to see this in El Universal. I want to see this in La Jornada. I want to see this in all the kind of, you know, popular print culture in Latin America, where people are making certain kinds of claims, and including within claim making, the sort of change media, right? It's just so that it's that saying like, hey, you know, we belong, but we're not just that we belong, but we're just organically a part of public and civic life.
Well, good point. Well, with that, I think we have to close this conversation, unfortunately. Thank you very much to all our panelists. Thank you to the audience for the questions and for hanging in there. And for those of you who are interested in the events we sponsor and we organize next week, we'll have the Tornaviaje discussion in Spanish. We distinguish Latin American historians and European historians on the colonialism, new colonialism of museografía in Europe. Thank you. Bye.
Well, gracias. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.